detection. The first paper is presented by Corrado Aron Visaggio and titled A Study on the Classification of Software Vulnerabilities when Using Deep Learning and Machine Learning Algorithms. So please, stage is yours.
Well, good afternoon. In my talk, I will present the results of a study about the errors that we can do when we try to classify software vulnerabilities with algorithms of machine learning and deep learning. Well, of course, all of us know that classification of vulnerabilities is of paramount importance for the vulnerability fixing process and for the assessment of our systems and networks, and of course, for the collection and classification of threats. The point is that the number of vulnerabilities is growing very fast. If we put, for instance, in the search box of the CV list on the Mitre website, some keyword like Android, for example, we obtain more than 6,000 entries. If we put iOS, we obtain more than 3,000 entries. And if we put Windows 10, we can obtain more than 1,000 entries. Classification currently is done mostly manually. And this is, of course, a time-consuming process. Some researchers propose to use some classification algorithm in order to make the process automatic and to make it quicker. That these classifiers can bring about some errors, so they could entail some misclassification of software vulnerabilities. A misclassification is the association of a vulnerability to a wrong class. So the goal of this study is to evaluate in a quantitative way the impact of misclassification on a large data set of software vulnerabilities. How do we carry out our study? We built 14 deep learning models and 5 shallow learning models, and we collected different vulnerabilities, and we made up 2 data sets, one with the duplicates and the other one without duplicates from the CVA MITRE website. We chose to have these two kinds of data set because we observed that the duplicates can alter the final results, and we see how. What we have so far, techniques of information retrieval have been applied for classifying attack vectors, especially extracting information from log files. Classification of vulnerabilities has been used for estimating the impact of vulnerability on the victim system. Classification has been used for computing the CVSS score. and to estimate the CWE classes corresponding to a CVE instance. So how we carried out the study. First, the methodology. We collected 134,000 of vulnerabilities. Of course, we took them from the CVE Mitre database, and we built a script in order to scrape all this information from the website. We collected vulnerabilities for 12 categories of vulnerability that you can see here in the table. Unfortunately, the number of vulnerabilities for each class is not perfectly balanced for all the vulnerabilities. Everyone knows that this is a problem, a well-known problem of this kind of study. Well, we calculated also the duplicates of vulnerabilities by using the Levenshtein distance. And so when we have the 100% similarity between two descriptions of vulnerability, we assume that the two vulnerabilities are duplicate. We tokenized the sentences to word by, and of course we used a stammer, the Porter stammer, for doing this, and for shallow learning models, we built the features vectors with counting words and with a term frequency inverse document frequency. For deep learning models, we converted into number sequences using basically word embeddings with Google's Word2Vec. Of course, we computed the performance of the classifiers with the usual metrics that are used in evaluating the classifiers, so accuracy, precision, and F1 score. We use these five algorithms that you can see in this slide for the shallow classifiers, and for the deep learning based classifiers, we use the other algorithm that you see here. We use both k-fold cross-validation, fixing k at 5, and train test split 8:20 for the two datasets. In these two tables, you can see the settings that we used for the two types of classifiers. Of course, I didn't go. I won't go in that in each classifier. I recall here just that we have 14 deep learning classifiers and 5 shallow classifiers. So let's come to the results. With regards to the shallow classifiers, the best one was the staking XG boost in both the datasets with and without duplicates. We computed also the intersection between the best classifier with the remaining classifiers. The intersection basically contains the common mix classifications between the two classifiers. And what we can see here is that the greatest intersection was obtained for the random forest. But what we can see here And this will be evident also in the other results, is that when we observed the dataset 1 and the dataset 2, we obtained very different results. Basically, for random forest, we have as a Rust category, code execution, then memory consumption, and then DOS. The best classification was obtained for HTTP response splitting. For DT, we obtained the same result of random forest. For nav base, we obtain a different top list. We obtain gain information as the Rust one, and then the file inclusion as the best one. When we skip to the deep learning, the best classifier was the one that used CNN and LSTM for the dataset 1, and for the dataset 2 was taking DNN. Also here, we can see that the intersection with the other classifiers vary a lot when we consider the dataset 1 and the dataset 2. This is a useful information for our conclusions, and I will recall this observation later. The results for the deep learning again are very different when we consider different classifiers. So when we consider CNN and LSTM, we obtain as the Rust one memory corruption, as the best one HTTP response splitting. For staking DNN, we obtain as Rust one the gain information, and as best one the memory corruption. In the third case, we obtain buffer overflow as the Rust one, and the memory corruption is the best. In this case, we obtain the 100% of correct classification. Finally, we can observe the confusion matrix. We can read this graph in this way. The class on the Y axis was classified as the corresponding class on the X axis. So for instance, if we see the class 12, this class was misclassified as the first class in 95% of the case. So what we see here is that dataset 2 shows a Rust situation compared with the dataset 1. So basically with duplicates, we have a better classification. Without duplicates, we have bad result. In the first case, what we can see is that the most of cases we have a misclassification that is smaller than the 10%, which is let's say quite good. The point is that if we move to the second graph, so the graph regarding the dataset 2, what we see is that the level of the misclassification gets higher. And in particular, we have some cases, a lot of cases, we could say, a lot of cases where the misclassification is greater than 40%, which is really a very bad result. So What we can conclude about this study? Of course, we need to adopt automatic solutions for classifying software vulnerabilities, because we should expect that over time and in the next future, the number of discovered vulnerabilities will increase very fast. Of course, machine and deep learning, along with text mining and natural language processing techniques, are the candidate solution for achieving this goal. The point is that classifiers are still too weak. And as we can see, the impact of misclassification is really relevant. And the very point of the problem, in my opinion, is that misclassification changes, the type of misclassification, the impact of misclassification changes according to the algorithms that we use for building the models, the decision models. So as future development, we will evaluate the classification performances of new vulnerabilities classification. Well, that's all.
Thank you, Aaron. We've been running a bit over time, so maybe we can take questions over Slack. No worries. We can move to the second talk. So we have Andrea Bisegna. Speaker is presenting her work on integration of pen testing tool for IDM protocols in a continuous delivery pipeline. Please, Andrea.
Okay, thank you. Sharing the screen, so I hope you can see it. Okay, great. So good afternoon, everybody. So my name is Andrea Bisegna, and what I'm going to present today is a joint work with Roberto Carbone and Silvio Ranese. So the title of the presentation is Integrating a Pen Testing Tool for Identity Management Protocols in a Continuous Delivery Pipeline. This is the outline of the speech. So at the beginning, we are going to provide you to provide some information about single sign-on and identity management protocols. Then we will discuss a wee bit about the DevSecOps philosophy. And then we are going to provide some an overview about MicroID GIM, a tool that we develop. So then we detail the problem that we try to solve, and we solve the problem with our solution, which is our contribution, and it is the design and the implementation of a continuous delivery pipeline for pen testing of identity management protocols. Then we conclude the speech with some conclusion and future work. So we identify as identity management protocols those protocols which implement single sign-on. Single sign-on is an authentication schema where a web application called service provider relies on a trusted third-party server called identity provider for the user authentication. Single sign-on offers an improved user experience, mitigated security risk, and required less effort from a service provider point of view in terms of developing code and to implement and adopt the authentication. Then we also notice that identity management protocols are increasingly important for digital infrastructures of both enterprises and public administrations. Two of the most known identity management protocols are some single sign-on V2.0, and which is used to access in Italian services of public administration, like in SPID, and OAuth OpenID Connect, which is supported by the vast majority of identity and access management systems, and are used by prominent software companies like Google and Microsoft. Regarding the DevSecOps philosophy, we can say that it is an extension of DevOps, which stands for the development and operations. And the goal of the DevSecOps is to integrate inside the DevOps the security in the process of continuous delivery. This is a requirement of our proposed solution. Then there are several state-of-the-art security practices that can be integrated into DevSecOps pipeline to ensure that automation and security are handled continuously. Then another requirement of our proposed solution is that there is no state-of-the-art pen testing tools that perform pen testing at protocol level integrated in the DevSecOps pipeline. Regarding MicroIDGIM, it is a pen testing tool for the automatic analysis of identity management protocols, and it performs automatic penetration testing on SAML, OAuth, and OpenID Connect, and it verifies that the compliance with the standard or regulation in terms of format of messages and mandatory field. This is a requirement of the solution that we propose. The MicroIDGIM pen testing tool is a plugin for BARP, the free version, so it's called Community Edition. And the BARP is a proxy tool, which is a software which intercepts HTTP messages between the client server and it hosted on the user agent, which in our case, it's the browser. So in order to use our plugin, we need to interact with the interface because BARP does not offer some APIs that can be invoked without involving the graphical user interface. And this last one is another requirement of our solution. So the implementation of the identity management protocols is notoriously error prone. System administrators and also developers have to deal with many implementation details, especially with the configuration and the deployment aspects. And the activities for a pen tester in case of a digital identity scenario require a deep knowledge of the protocols. Then at the state of the art, there is no DevSecOps tool which perform automatic penetration testing at the protocol level. And also a recent work from IBM has shown that those companies which apply deployed security automation are saving cost in case of breaches. So in order to try to solve those problems, we design a continuous delivery pipeline for pen testing of identity management protocols, which meets the previous requirements. We implement the continuous delivery pipeline using GitLab as infrastructure and MicroIDGIM as a pen testing tool. Then in the context of a joint effort with the Italian Polygraphic Institute and the State Mint IPZS, we had this collaboration to build a digital identity infrastructure. So we use our pipeline to assess this real use case scenario where an identity management protocol implementation was provided by IPZS, and where we used the CIE, which is the Italian electronic identity card, for the authentication. This is our high level architectures of the proposed solutions. As we can see, there are two actors. There is the developer and the security team. We also want to highlight that the black dashed arrow are the actions that are performed by humans, while the red arrows are the operation that are performed automatically by the automation. So we also can see that we have a repository where the source code is stored, and there is the continuous integration and continuous delivery system. We have also the security team machine where there is an email client and the pen testing tool. And then we have the system under test with the identity provider and the service provider. So in this case, the steps are, so the developer push some code in the repository. Then thanks to the continuous integration and continuous delivery, the solution will be deployed in the system under test. Then at the same time, an email will be sent to the email client of the security team, which contains some information that will be used by the security team to add in the penetration testing tools in order to let it work. So then the third step is the security team execute MicroIDGIM and then perform the test on the system under test. If the penetration testing tool detect any vulnerabilities, an automatic security feedback will be sent to the continuous integration, continuous delivery system, and will notify the developer that any vulnerability have been discovered in the system under test. So the solution that we proposed, as we can see, meet the requirements, which are automatic build, deploy of identity management implementation. Then we have the penetration testing tools that perform penetration testing at protocol level. And another requirement was that the tool was installed locally because we need this interaction with the GUI. And then the tool perform some penetration testing at compliance to verify the compliance with the standard on the system under test. So to access the proposed solution, we used GitLab for the continuous integration and continuous delivery system, which contains the source code of SAML Shibboleth Identity Provider Speed Compliance, and of course customized by IPZS, and then a stub service for the service provider, which it's needed to perform the authentication. Then we used MicroIDGIM as a pen testing tool. Again, it's installed locally on the security team machine. And we have the system under test, which is the deployment of the implementation stored in the GitLab repository, and where MicroIDGIM will perform the security pen testing. After running MicroIDGIM, it identifies two possible vulnerabilities only by checking the content of the SAML messages. But after a deeper analysis, we identify that those vulnerabilities, the tool verify that those vulnerabilities were just false positives one. So to conclude, in this speech, we present the design and the implementation of a continuous delivery pipeline using GitLab infrastructure and MicroIDGIM as a pen testing tool. And then we assess an implementation based on SAML and speed compliance provided by IPZS. As a future work, we plan to support other multi-party web application like online payment services. Thanks.
Thank you, Andrea. I have just a quick question.
Sure.
The threat model for these protocols is quite complicated because most of the time you consider web attacks, network attacks, you might have a malicious IDP. So I was curious to know which threats are in scope of your solution.
We identified that some messages were not compliance with the standard. Indeed, some mandatory field were missing inside the XAML response that it will go into the service provider. One was related to a parser basically issue on the identity provider.
Okay, so basically you check with respect to best practices from the specification.
Yes.
Okay, I see. Thank you. So we can move to the next talk. So we have ProFuzz Bench, a benchmark for stateful protocol fuzzing. The speaker is Roberto Natella. Please.
Hello, good afternoon. Let me share my screen. Okay, you should be seeing my screen.
Yes.
Yeah. Okay. So this is a presentation about fuzz testing. I think most of you are familiar with fuzzing, but just recap the main concept just in case. Fuzzing is a security testing technique. It's for vulnerability identification. It is about generating huge volumes of inputs to attack some software. For example, some program for image parsing or for network communication. For example, on the web, I found this nice animation. It is about the AFL, a very well-known fuzzing tool. It takes a file as a binary. For example, this should be the binary of an image. What a fuzzer does is to continuously mutate that file. So it takes the original file. It changes a few bytes into the original file, and the mutated file is fed to the program and the test. And it is repeated many times, millions of times, to find out which mutations can crash your target software. So, you can see AFL, after some preliminary mutations, it messes with the original file. So it randomly changes byte, reverses the order, adds more, or removes parts of the original file until it can find some crash of the target. And this is very effective to find out zero-day vulnerabilities. In this presentation is about stateful protocols. It's a special form of fuzzing. Unfortunately, fuzzing network servers is still challenging. Fuzzing techniques are very mature, but this is still a challenge to take a fuzzer and to apply it to a real-world complex network server. The main challenge is about the stateful nature of network protocols. For example, this figure is about FTP protocol, very very simple, very well known. If you take a tool like AFL, like the one before, so if you just bytes in network traffic, what you get is that the fuzzing mostly hits the few states in the state machine of the protocol. So the protocol mostly spends its time in these states on the left. This is the part of the state machine most easily reached by inputs. But finding the vulnerabilities is about also reaching a deep state space in the state machine. So, for example, states in the right part that are only reached by very specific inputs. So that's where vulnerability are hidden. So, okay, it is an open challenge how to perform efficiently fuzzing on this kind of network protocols. And to make it a reality, fuzzing research needs a benchmark. You know, science is about, okay, making a reproducible experiments to demonstrate that some technique is effective to fix some problem. So in our case, researchers want to develop new algorithms, they need to demonstrate in their papers, in their research, that the algorithms advance the state of the art by finding new vulnerabilities or by better covering some protocol. So, of course, there are many benchmarks, many target programs for trying out fuzzing techniques. For example, there is a Google Fuzz Bench, Lava, the Cybergram Challenge, and many others. They are programs. Sometimes they have known vulnerabilities, and of course, there are many unknown vulnerabilities. So, okay, people try. They are going on these ones. The problem, what's the problem is that these benchmarks are mostly about stateless programs. So, for example, most of the benchmarks are about parsers for multimedia, so image processors, video processors. So it's stateless. It just take one image, process the image, and then, okay, the image is forgotten. It's not stateful processing. Or data compression. Utilities from Linux and operating systems and so on. So very few network protocols. So what we proposed, me and my colleague Tuan, we developed Pro Fuzz Bench. It is a benchmark for stateful protocols. We included the protocol implementations for several well-known protocols like FTP and some others. We took popular open source projects implementing that protocol, and of course we focused on protocols of interest for researchers. So we look at past papers, we look at commercial and books, and we selected the protocols that were covered by some previous paper or previous book or commercial tool. So we took the effort to automate the fuzzing of that target. So this will make the life easier for the researcher. You know, if you have experience with fuzzing, most of the effort is about putting the automation on place. So installing the fuzzer in the target software to automate the deployment of the testing. That's not the place I'm part of fuzzing, and we take care of this, so researchers can focus on better algorithms for fuzzing. And our benchmark also includes two baselines. We have two fuzzers already integrated in the benchmark, so researcher can compare their algorithms with the baseline we included. And of course, we took the opportunity to find out some open problems for future research. So this is mostly about ongoing work, not only for us, but also for the community in general. At the moment, we included about 10 protocols, including, very basic ones like SMTP, FTP, some protocols with crypto like TLS, SSH. And we have also more complex protocols like SIP and some others. And for each of these, we have one implementation, one open source implementation. For some protocols, we have more than one. We in the table, we have two FTP servers. After we the first release, two researchers contributed with more FTP servers. So at the moment, we have four FTP servers in the benchmark. And all of these have some stateful behavior. So this is a good target for experimenting with stateful protocol fuzzing. So what's included in our benchmark? It's basically based on Docker for automation. So we have Docker files for bidding containers with all in. So the fuzzer, the program and the test, and configuration needed for running the target. And we also take care of, solving some problem to apply fuzzing. For example, we have de-randomized the target program, so to have reproducibility. We also have introduced message markers. So this is about the network protocols. So it's not just a stream of bytes. We have packets, messages. So we added markers to make easier for the fuzzer to separate the messages So, okay, if you want to build some intelligent fuzzer based on this knowledge about packets, you can do that more easily based on our markers. Also, we embedded in the traces the states. So you know about the state by reading the message traces. So, okay, more on this problem later, but okay, if you want to explore some state machine-based algorithm, you can base your algorithm based on this information we included in the patched software. Of course, we also introduced the coverage-driven instrumentation and the use of stuff for fuzzing. Then, of course, we can deploy multiple containers to run fuzzers in parallel. So it is about having huge volumes of testing. So parallelization is very important. And okay, we collect plenty of data from these executions. And finally, we report on coverage at the moment. Coverage, for example, statement coverage, branch coverage, and protocol state coverage over time. For example, these are the two baselines. We included a basic fuzzer. It is AFL attached to a socket, basically. And the blue one is a protocol-aware fuzzer. It is called AFL-MET. So this is a state-of-the-art stateful fuzzing. So you can compare to this one in your own research. Some problems we found out during this experience to build this benchmark. For example, we found out that some servers are very challenging to fuzz. For example, SIP, for example, Camaglio SIP server, it takes multiple clients to have some meaningful interaction with the server. You need not only the fuzzer to talk with the server, but you also need another client. You know, SIP is about making calls. So we have a caller and a callee. The SIP server is in the middle. So we can't have some protocol without three actors. So we needed to introduce a third element in the process. And this makes fuzzing very tricky. So, okay, this is already solving this benchmark, but we see this as an important problem for the future. And another problem is about configuration of the server. The attack surface of the server depends a lot on how the server is configured, which features are enabled, which features are disabled. So, okay, we took some decision to configure this server, but okay, we feel that the researcher can explore this aspect more. So by changing configuration, having the fuzzer attack the configurations to find out how the attack surface can be affected by vulnerabilities. Of course, another challenge is about the performance. We were contacted by two research groups. They wanted our benchmark to experiment with their techniques to accelerate stateful fuzzing. So, for example, by taking snapshots of the servers to have quicker iterations. So this is an ongoing research, very important area. And another one is about determinism. If the server is multi-threaded or event-based, the behavior is not anymore deterministic. So this is an assumption of fuzz tools that is not anymore true for stateful servers. So this is another challenge for future research. And finally, okay, maybe I'm out of time, state identification. So having some algorithms to learn about the state machine of a protocol without any formal specification. So, okay, that's all for my presentation. Of course, you can find more on the GitHub repository of the benchmark. You can just search for ProfatDench. There is a technical report for more information about it. And of course, feel free to contribute with any feedback. Thank you for attending.
Thank you, Roberto. Just a quick question from my side.
Okay.
If anyone wanted to extend the benchmark to add more software, what would be the complexity? How much work would be needed manually to extend
okay.
it?
Okay, we provide a very detailed instruction for doing so. The easiest way is to take inspiration from the programs we already included. We have quite diverse programs. So it's likely that your own program is similar to some of our ones. So having a look at them is the first thing to do. And of course, we have suggestion for integrating your own benchmark, but it's mostly art, how to best integrate some web software to a father. So there is no unique technique. So we provide examples, guidelines to make it easier.
Okay, thank you. We can move to the next speaker, who is Gabriele Costa. Gabriele is presenting work on vulnerable web application scanner.
Okay, thank you. We can move to the next speaker, who is Gabriele Costa. Gabriele is presenting work on vulnerable web application scanner.
Okay, thank you. Let me share my screen. Okay. So you should see my slides now.
Yes.
Can you see them? Can you see my slides, Stefano?
Yes. Oh. Yes, it's working.
Okay. So I'm Gabriele Costa. I'm associate professor at IMT School for Advanced Studies in Lucca. And I'm going to present you this work that we made together with Enrico Russo from University of Genova and Andrea Valenza, that is now employed at Minded Security, but was previously a PhD student at the University of Genova. So our work is about then vulnerable application scanner. So what is that? Let's start from the very basics. So when you do security scanning or penetration testing activities, we are very used to have a preliminary stage, which is about information gathering. Information gathering includes a lot of steps, but the main technical one is security scanning. So typically we employ some piece of software, some web application to perform a scan, which means generating some requests toward a target, collecting responses from this target, and generating a report. And the report here is very relevant for this work, so I highlighted this work. What is the goal of someone performing a scan? So typically listing open ports, finding services that are running on the target machine, checking software versions, doing banner grabbing, and so on and so forth. So this is typically a preliminary stage for any attack activity, or even for people driven by curiosity wanting to scan a system. Doing a network scan is such a common operation online that is not even perceived in general as an offensive operation in some context. So if you have an intrusion detection mechanism, sometimes you have an alert if someone is performing a scan with Nmap or other tools, but this is not typically enough to say I'm under attack. So this is just to highlight how common it is to perform a network scan. But if it is part of an attack, typically what we expect is that the people performing the scan are also people that will perform an attack at a certain point in future after they collected enough information. So this is unidirectional, right? So we have some analysts or attacker performing a scan and then eventually performing an attack against the target, okay? But actually, why should we assume this? In general, there's no reason why the target of a scan should be passive, okay? So if we consider this perspective, it is highly possible that the target of a scan might counterattack the author of a scan, which means that if we control the scan target, we might generate malicious responses to trigger vulnerabilities in the scanner, and in particular, in the report generated by the scanner, for instance. So the real question now is, are the scanners vulnerable, and which kind of vulnerabilities they might suffer from? And we investigated this attacker model in a previous paper presented at RAID 2020, where we actually defined this new attacker model and we tested it in the wild. So if you have seen this movie, Jurassic Park, you know that sometimes even if you believe you are the hunter, you might become the victim. And in particular, this is the case that we are modeling here. So the author of the scan is now the victim of an attack, which is automatically executed by the scan target. Okay. So our attack model consists in this. When someone starts a scan, the target identifies this traffic as an attempt to scan, and instead of answering normally, returns some malicious payloads that can be used to trigger some vulnerabilities in the scanner. So actually we tested these in the wild, and we found out that 72 scanners were vulnerable to just to cross-site scripting. Okay, so this is just cross-site scripting vulnerabilities in the scanner. There might be many more, but these results highlight that, let's say, developers of network scanners are not aware of these risk. Okay. And to further highlight this problem, we found that even a mainstream tool like Metasploit Pro was actually vulnerable to this kind of attack. We don't believe that people developing Metasploit Pro are not aware about cross-site scripting, so they know cross-site scripting very well, but they just did not expect this to be a possibility. The idea is that many of these tools just use Nmap to trigger the scan, to perform the scan, and they read the output of Nmap and they embed it in their HTML reports without sanitizing this, because they don't believe this might be a vector of an attack. But actually we proved this is the case, so this might be a vector of an attack. So what is the problem about this new attacker model? Well, if you want to raise awareness of people, of developers, we need the training environments. There are many training environments for vulnerable web applications. You might have used Gruyere or then vulnerable web applications, or there are so many others, where you can get experience about what a cross-site scripting is and how to sanitize input. But the problem is that there's no environment for training against this new attacker model. So we implemented an environment called Divas that you can find here on GitHub that includes a collection of vulnerabilities. All of them are inspired by real world vulnerabilities. So we replicate vulnerabilities that we have found in real tools online, and we made a challenge out of them. We made challenges out of them. And this tool also includes a sub package which is called Nex, which is basically a scan target that you can configure to script your attack. Okay, so you don't have to implement a web application to answer to the scan of Divas. You can use the built-in scan target, and you can just put there the answers that you want to return. You can create web pages, you can create JavaScript contents, and so on and so forth, that are going to be retrieved by the scanner, by the Diva scanner, and you can use to solve the challenges. Okay. Each challenge basically consists of a single PHP page where you can scan the target with different techniques. For instance, in this example, you can scan using the PHP get headers functionality. And then the result of this call is embedded in the output, and you check whether you can trigger some cross-site scripting vulnerability or other kinds of vulnerabilities. So let's see an example. This is a demo of how a challenge in Divas work, and we are replicating the Metasploit Pro scenario. So I said you that Metasploit had this vulnerability, these vulnerabilities that actually were included in two CVEs, a quite risky one, because you could have triggered remote code execution of Metasploit on the analyst machine. So there was a possibility to activate a reverse shell there. So basically we replicated this scenario that is now not possible anymore on Metasploit Pro, because they fixed it with an emergency patch, the framework. But you can test it on Divas. So basically the idea is that one of the challenges consists of a port scanner application that invokes Nmap in the very same way as Metasploit Pro does. This triggers an HTTP request to the target that you have to configure properly in order to return a certain malicious payload that you see here at the bottom of this picture. So since this answer is clipped, so you cannot put there any amount of characters, you are constrained to a fixed dimension, you have to put there a minimal text that is a malicious payload. So you have to generate a JavaScript file and to provide it as a source of a script tag. This is going to be embedded in the scanner report, and which will eventually retrieve this file and execute the content. The content has a fetch operation that is used to open a reverse shell and to connect to the attacker machine. Okay. And that's the scenario that was actually possible to run on Metasploit Pro. You can see it from a screenshot taken from Divas, where you can see actually the nmap port scan PHP, okay, which is one of the challenges of Divas. So you start the scan of a target that has been obfuscated here, and you see the output of nmap that is embedded inside the scanner report, HTML report, okay? So the idea is that this is the request performed by nmap to scan an HTTP service, and in the server version field, we are injecting the script, the malicious script that you can't see here because there's no text to be displayed, but the script is actually embedded here. This triggers the fetch operation from the attack.js script, and we can open the reverse shell as in the example, okay? So to conclude my talk, we actually developed Divas, which is this training environment for attacking network scanners, which is something completely new. There are no other proposals for this kind of training scenarios. Divas has quite a number of challenges there. I can't remember the actual number, but should be around 15 challenges, actually, inspired by real-world vulnerabilities that we actually found in the wild. I didn't say that, but part of the vulnerability that I reported in the beginning are still there. So we made a responsible disclosure to all of the developers, and this took a couple of months. But then some of them didn't answer, and some of them refused to fix the vulnerability. So you can still find that these tools are vulnerable to cross-site scripting. Another interesting fact that again confirms that the new attacker model is quite dangerous and quite common around in the real world is that just while developing Divas and X, just testing the functionality during the development process, we applied it to other tools that are available, and we found other 12 new vulnerabilities, okay, that I'm not listing here, but you can find them in the paper. And interestingly enough, one of them was in an OWASP tool, JoomScan, that is a scan for Joomla content management systems, okay? And again, this tool was found vulnerable because that performs a scan of certain resources that are Joomla specific, and you can inject a cross-site scripting code. So this vulnerability is pretty dangerous, and many analysts might be actually exposed to attacks just because they're using scanning tools that do not sanitize scan responses. Okay, and that should be everything. So if you have any questions, I will be glad to answer.
Thank you, Gabriele. So that was quite fun to me because I never thought about this issue. So I was curious whether you tried out to understand whether someone is exploiting that in the wild.
Thank you, Gabriele. So that was quite fun to me because I never thought about this issue. So I was curious whether you tried out to understand whether someone is exploiting that in the wild.
That is a very interesting, very relevant question. So we still don't know, because for the very nature of this kind of attack, it is very difficult to spot out, let's say, targets that exploit these techniques. There might be offensive honeypots exploiting these, but to the best of our knowledge, we have no clue about this. It is a concrete possibility. If someone knows of these vulnerabilities, they didn't report about it because we couldn't find anything in the literature, but we cannot exclude that someone is using it. So really, that's an open question.
Thank you. So we can move to the next talk. The next speaker is Andrea Fioraldi. He's talking about fuzzing binaries for memory safety errors with QA Sun. Please.
Okay. Do you hear me?
Yes, working.
Okay. Hi to all, I'm Andrea, a PhD student in the S3 lab of EUROCOM, and today I'll talk about fuzzing binaries for memory safety errors with QSM. I'll start talking about what is fuzzing. Fuzzing is a very effective random testing technique that proved to be very effective in uncovering vulnerabilities and bugs in programs. And the main idea behind fuzzing is to repeatedly execute a program under test with inputs that are generated from scratch. And the program, and we look for, of course, for crashes inside programs when executing these inputs. When designing a fuzzer, when improving a fuzzing algorithm, the challenge is to trigger as many possible bugs or faults in a given time. This is our efficiency metric. To do that, a popular twist of fuzzing is coverage-gated fuzzing that improves the ability of traditional fuzzers that just generate random input in finding the crashes. Because of course, if you can stress more program points in the program, you can find bugs in these in program points. The main idea behind this technique is to generate inputs not from scratch anymore, but starting from other inputs that are stored in a corpus. So inputs are generated by mutations, and during the execution of the program under test, we don't look anymore only for crashes, but also for new covered program points. So if we see a new portion of the code that was not previously seen, we add the generated input to the corpus for further mutation. So this is an evolutionary approach for fuzzing. To improve the detection of faults, we can not just improve fuzzing from the algorithm side, but we can also make bugs that are not that are silent, that we cannot immediately observe because they don't lead to a failure, observable. To do that, for memory safety, there are a lot of sanitizers that are some compiler-based instrumentation and runtimes that can be enabled at compilation times using most of the off-the-shelf compilers such as GCC and CLang, or nowadays even the Microsoft compiler. The most popular is Address Sanitizer that inserts checks each memory access in the program and check at runtime the validity of each memory access toward shadow of memory. Shadow of memory is like a big map that keep track for each byte of the program if that memory is valid or not. So for instance, when I free a memory on the heap, I mark the buffer that was free as invalid. And so if I have a memory access that touch that buffer, there is a fault, a failure reported. So we can observe also all the type of memory related issues that don't normally lead to a crash. Then there is also memory sanitizer that catch the usage of analyzed memory, and undefined behavior sanitizer that catch errors such like interior flow and many other sanitizers. But what about fuzzing closed source software? What about we want to test a binary in a black box fashion? For the coverage part, if we want to do coverage guided fuzzing, we have plenty of options like dynamic binary translation using emulation with QEMU or some dynamic binary instrumentation tools like Interpin and so on. We have also hardware support using InterPT, ARM CoreSite, and other options. And there is also static rewriting that rewrites the binaries in certain instrumentation. But it is a problematic matter because cannot handle a complex control for graph, cannot handle dynamic generated code like a JIT compiler, and it's not so easy to set up for a user. But for sanitization and fuzzing of binaries, we have just one option, that is static rewriting, with all the possible issues that static rewriting has. And in this case, we have just one tool that works with fuzzer, that is Retrowrite, that works just with x86-64. The most used and popular tool to fuzz black box binary on Linux at this time is FR++ in QEMU mode, that give us a nice set of features like very good performance, like thanks to block caching and persistent mode, also the ability to go deep in code coverage by passing roadblocks like comparison instruction, and it is also, this is a very important feature, it also works with a wide range of architecture, which, because as you know, QEMU is the standard for emulation. This is just an example of fuzzing up binary with FR++ QEM. So here comes our idea. For source-based approaches, we instrument programs for coverage collection and sanitization to uncover silent faults. For black box binary, we use QEMU to get coverage. And so what about sanitized program with QEMU? The benefit to do that is that we can sanitize libraries, because if we do static rewriting or if we use the compiler approach, we cannot instrument the libraries that are provided to the program by the operating system, because they are already compiled. With emulation, we emulate the entire process, so we emulate the libraries too, and so we can instrument inside the emulator also the libraries. QEMU is fast because it uses a JIT, so use a dynamic binary translator. So we are not using options like trampoline-based sanitizations, another option that we were exploring in the past. We can put the shadow of memory used by address sanitize outside the address space of the guest, so it cannot be corrupted because it lives entirely in the host, in the emulator. It's very easy to use because it's just a FR++. It's a tool optimized for usability. But unfortunately, we cannot sanitize stack and global variables because, as any other binary approach, this information is lost during compilation. Our tool, we named it to QEMU Address Sanitizer, QASAN. And its architecture is composed in two parts. One is a runtime library that lives in the host, and the other is a QEMU extension that is basically a patch to QEMU that lives in the emulator. We instrument the guest, instrumenting all the memory access and checking the memory accesses to the shadow of memory. We instrument the calls to keep track of the shadow stack. In the runtime, we replace the allocator with our allocator that insert red sounds that are like padding to check overflow and quarantine that are some techniques to check for double freeze and so on. And this is possible thanks to our idea to break the guest host isolation using some hypercodes for checking the validity of memory. We do that in two ways, with a fake syscall or more performantly with a backdoor, that is a common name for hypercodes using a fake instruction. In this case, you can see our fake x86 instruction that we insert in the emulator that give us a huge speed up for communicating from the guest to the host. We also hook some widely used function in the standard library, because yes, we can sanitize the libraries, but there can be some users that don't want to sanitize the entire address space, because yes, sanitization is instrumentation. Instrumentation introduces a performance overhead, so maybe the user wants to sanitize just one, the main binary. And to do that, we provide some hooks using symbol hooking to check the arguments of common functions, like a compile-based address sanitizer does. We faced the problem to hot patch the standard library, because in some highly optimized scenario, like the standard library, the C standard libraries of Linux, memory safety is violated. It's violated doing some assumption of the architecture. It's violated in a safe way. So maybe there is an overflow of 1-2 bytes in read, assuming the size of the pages in the operating system, to implement some fast routines like memcopy using the vectorization. Of course, our approach cannot work with these functions, because for us, they are detected as false positive, because yes, they are memory violations. And so we hot patch using dynamic code patching this function, inserting some trampolines to the code in the guest, to our unoptimized version of these functions. In terms of evaluation, in the Juliet dataset, that is a common dataset used to measure the performance of memory checkers, we evaluated against the compile-based counterpart, that is address sanitizer of CLang, and bargaining man check. And you can see that our performance is pretty similar. Of course, like any other dynamic analysis technique on fuzzing, we don't have false positive. We must not have false positive. And you can see that we are even better to the technique-based buffer overflow that the LLVM address sanitizer, because we instrument all the libraries. And our performance is very similar to Valgrind, with it's almost the same, with the difference that Chiasm can be used to fuzz programs, but Valgrind is super slow, cannot collect the coverage for fuzzing, and cannot be used for fuzzing. For the fuzzing part, we use the Google Fuzzer Test Suite dataset, and you can see that our approach compared to the baseline, that is FR++ QEMU, uncover more bugs, a lot more bugs, you can see. And the slowdown that we introduce is very nice, because on average, it's less than 2 times lower than the baseline. That it's a very similar number to the slowdown introduced by the compiler instrumentation of address sanitizer when compared to the program that is compiled without instrumentation. Last, QEMU address sanitizer can be used not just for fuzzing, also as a debugging tool. We provide a lot of information in our reports when there is a memory evaluation. You can see a report that is very similar to address sanitizer on binaries, and it is used by the community also to debug crashes. The future direction is to improve this approach for full system sanitization using QEMU system, for instance, for firmwares, IoT devices, and so on, to implement other sanitizer like memory sanitizer, and to add the stack user after return detection, that is a common class of bugs that can be catched using binary memory approaches. Thanks for following this talk. We made the Chiasm free and open on GitHub. You can hack on it, play with it, fuzz your software with it. You can even fork it to extend Chiasm for your own research.
Thank you, Andrea. Due to timing constraints, I say we bring questions offline over Slack, and we move to the last talk. So the speaker is Mario Angelelli. Is presenting work on security testing reuse, enhancing active cyber defense in public administration.
Good. Thank you. Can you hear me?
Yes, working.
Perfect. Just a moment for the slides. First, I'd like to thank you, all of you, all the organizers, all the I hope the slides can be seen.
Not yet.
Maybe I don't go full screen, maybe it's better.
We can only see your face, basically.
Okay. I'm trying. Just a moment. Okay, now you should see.
Yes.
Okay. I avoid going screen, maybe. Okay. Thank you. I will go short. First, I'd like, as I said, I'd like to thank you, all of the organizers and the previous speakers. My name is Mario Angelelli. I'm a researcher at the University of Salento, the Campi Laboratory. This is a joint work with Cristian Catalano, Paolo Prune, Francesco Tommasi of the CR Lab, the Cybersecurity Research Lab. And the topic is going is about relevant issue. This is not a much technical topic. It's more like an operational topic based on the notion of code reuse within and security code reuse within the public administration. There are some very well-known premises. I will not spend much time on these regarding the relevance, the actual relevance of the compliance with law and defense in the ICT sensitive public context, which make the information as the status the status of the fifth dimension of work and workforce. This led governmental bodies to adopt or to create a new governmental bodies with these ad hoc responsibilities, that is the definition of rules, guidelines to counterattack cyber cyber crime and cyber cyber attacks. I will focus on the national level. I will be go brief with this. It is the notion of information defense in at the national level. In the context of public administration is quite present. In 2013, it has been adapted in 2017. With the definition of the national cybersecurity architecture. There are several actors which are involved in the definition, the guidelines, the rules regulating cybersecurity in the public administrations. And obviously there are also the alignment with the European level through the NIS, the Network of Information Security, Cybersecurity Regulation, and critically the GDPR. I will go to a more two additional more technical premises, that is proactive cyber defense, which is the set of all those techniques which are needed to not only respond defensive approach to attacks, but also to use preventive sometimes offensive techniques in order to detect, prevent the exploitation of cyber vulnerabilities. Finally, there is the old known concept of code reuse, which has been adopted in the context of public administration within the CINI white paper and in the ARGID guidelines in 2019. This is based on two, there are many principles. The two principles I'm going to focus on are the use of open source projects for source code in public administration and a set of constraints which have to be all satisfied in order to define eligible solutions. This leads to three consequential steps. For the adoption of software in the public administration, the identification of specific needs, the analysis of the available solution based on the principle of usable codes and the open source solution. Obviously, if not all the requirements, the guidelines are satisfied and all the needs, the specific needs, there is an analysis of other solutions, of the feasibility of new solution or the acquisition of current proprietary solutions. There are some problems I'm going to address. The first one is that proactive defense has many advantages, both in terms of resilience of the country system, but also in terms of economical advantages of savings, both not only economics, but also reputational. There are many techniques there are regarding proactive cyber defense. There are vulnerability assessment, the penetration testing, mimicking real life attacks, which are based both on known vulnerabilities and zero day events, static analysis on the source code or on or through reverse engineering, dynamic analysis with the execution of code, and so also depending on inputs. This is also a question that is related to the some specific tests that have been performed, and semi-automatic tools which combine automatic tools with human eyes. There are some problems, as I said, that both external constraints, public administration should often have to find solutions in short times with very specific constraints, which however makes proprietary software also niche product with very specific requirements and applications more likely to be adopted, but they are less likely to be under the eye of the ethical hacker program of the or the bounty programs. And then there are internal issues, verification costs, replicability of analysis, as also non-deterministic techniques or machine learning based techniques are also related to explainability of the phenomenon, limits of automatic tools related to the human factor, or specific language issues such as for JavaScript this code injection. So there are different features that have to be faced in terms of proactive cyber defense. As I said, this is a high level proposal to implement the guidelines by regarding cybersecurity in public administration with the introduction of a new class of processes which use information content regarding the security test as a resource, both in terms of security and in the, some sense economical terms. This is there are three basic assumptions that are the introduction of a criterion to connect the nodes not only based on functional approach, but also on the nominal approach. There could be nodes in the public administration network that could be, even if as have a different function, could use the same software assets. These criterion then can discriminate the nodes also based not only on their status, on the centrality, but also on the effective software assets. Assets they use. And then there is I will show that they this criterion helps to define and formalize the logical schemes which can translate the guidelines in a software architecture to be implemented in, or to at least to be proposed for on dedicated test beds. There are some objectives that this proposal aims to solve. The first one is, as I said, that in encompassing code reuse for PA for public administrations, as suggested by the guidelines, cost reduction for verification, in particular also the enhancement of open source solutions, extending the sets of eligible solutions. This is done by sharing in a distributed matter information regarding the criteria to be satisfied. If we will show later where this applies. Finally, seeing the information regarding security test as a resource, there are the classical issue of resource optimization. It is avoid redundant verification and exploiting the potential vulnerabilities also in different environments. For for example, con different in different configuration settings. There are four functionalities on which this architecture is based, that are the complementarity of resources and requirements, that is, within the whole public administration network, the only solution to be analyzed are those with incomplete security information. In this way, also, this is the second point, also small public administration can protect their assets, because if they are not, they have not the capability to cover all the tests to get compliance with the guidelines, they can be supported by the information shared by other nodes using the same assets. This is a relevant point, since public administration network is a multi-layered body. So the vulnerabilities also in peripheric nodes could provide privilege escalation, leading to criticality also in central nodes. There is an official channel which maybe could be managed by specific authorities, for example, the CERTS, but there are also tasks beyond the CERTS scope, that is the active participation of local technical staff. Both, for each public administration node, the technical manager should both in a push mode receive a security test report, for example, the CVCC SS score, or pull mode, that is upload a modification of their assets. In this way, proactivity of cybersecurity is enhanced, since the nodes to be protected contribute to the protection of the whole network. These are the three logical requirements. There should be distinction between the software vendor and the vendor who performs the test. There are three standard scenarios, but we also open up the way for non-standard scenarios, also envisaging future modification, both due to technology and administration. This is the first scheme. I will go brief on this. That is the scheme for the acquisition of information acquisition associated to new software introduced in a given public administration node. As you can see, there is a public administration and there is a separation between the software vendor and the security test vendor. And obviously there is the platform which regulates the processes. This is the second scheme, the information retrieval and update regarding the existing software, the public administration node. Further details on this will be provided in an upcoming paper. The third scheme is the information retrieval and the update regarding new software in a given public administration node. I will go brief to conclusion. First, I'd like to mention why is the notion of information shared for security test can be relevant. This can be relevant because it can provide a way to prompt transparency and adoption of good practices in a formal way in the in a complex network like public administration. There are some both microeconomic and macroeconomic effects which can be measured and monitored, which are related to the notion of economy of scope, that is the that different objectives, different functionalities in the public administration are achieved through the use of the same production factor. In this case, information coming from security tests. This has a large number of effects, which will be detailed elsewhere. I would just mention that there are both local effects in terms of competitive advantage and, as I said, support to small public administration, and the macroeconomic effects, since more public saving implies more savings, implies more investment, both in different sectors and within the public administration. This also relates to the European level, both in terms of state relationship, but also vendors acting and present on the platform on the international level. These are the future perspectives. This is, as I said, a high level discussion, but it will be investigated further in two levels, both theoretically in terms of the value and implication in terms of reward model to enhance transparency within the network, the value, the added value of information from security test, and then balancing between the abstraction of this structure with a specific situation where there are validation procedures, protocols to provide information without disclosure. This is done through the confirmation of specific queries in closed answer queries. And finally, also the data separation and the introduction of security level layers between within the public administration in order to prevent the privilege escalation access through the, also in this case, the well-known principle of least privilege. I'm done, and thank you again for your attention.
Thank you, Mario. We are slightly over time, but almost on time. So if there are questions, we can answer them, ask them on Slack. Just wanted to thank all the speakers for their works and all the attendees for being present at the session. Have a nice end of the day.
Thank you.
All the speakers for their works.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Thank you. Goodbye.